This is quite a moment for you.
It is quite a moment. It is as crazy as anyone can imagine, and as crazy as many of my friends told me it was gonna be. And it's also, a nice ride, and it's good. It's fun.
So what did you, when did you make the conversion? I mean, I think the place where I first really recognized you was in Che, where I felt you should have been nominated for that, a supporting actor.
Oh,
As a brilliant performance
Thank
and a
you.
movie that I love,
Thanks.
all the hours of which I actually pushed to get into the Chinese. The AFI ran into the Chinese
Really?
theater in that giant
Oh,
screen,
yeah.
and people stayed for the whole thing. It was
Well,
crazy.
I was born, raised, and educated on stage in the theater in Mexico, and I come from the time where you could watch a play, a 4 hour long play. I just watched an opera, a Los Angeles opera, for 5 hours. So that's me, I always want more for my money. So when people were talking about how long Che was and all that, I said, yeah, don't ask me, man. I mean, I want more and more and more. And I've seen one and a half films that are 1.5 hours long that are really, really boring, and that you can just, you can't stand still. It's like, please get me out of here. So it's not the length, but the actual, power of the material. And I love Steven Soderbergh's films, Che. And the great thing about those films is that you can watch them separately and still get the whole thing, because they talk about two different periods of time of the life of Che Guevara. And you can understand exactly what's going on. So I'm glad you saw it.
I always feel like it's the two pieces really fit together as, what happens when you have a Fidel character in your life and what happens when you don't.
Yeah, that too. Yeah.
Well-meaning is not enough. It's like you need
That's
to have somebody who knows how to keep the
yeah.
trains going.
I agree with you. And it was great, that those films, they began the whole thing on this side of the border, let's put it that way. Because I've done some other films before, but that was the first time that things began happening, and my first time in Cannes, and many, many great things began happening. And after that, I did Weeds, and then this, and it's been a long way, a long journey, because I've been around for many, many years, beginning in the theater in Mexico, my brothers and my parents, ever since we were kids. And
So your whole family is in the
yeah,
theater.
my parents made each other start in theater in their hometown in Torreón, Coahuila, up north Mexico. And then they moved to Mexico City, and my brothers and I were born. And we grew up in the theater, sometimes working in it, doing professional plays ever since we were very young, and then or going with my parents everywhere in Mexico, and playing backstage and this and that. So, and then I remember I could never stand still, and never be at home. My mom would always complain that I was never home. And I would be playing soccer all day long, the streets of Tlatelolco, and all the barrios that we grew up in. And then I moved to New York when I was 22 because I wanted to learn English. I thought I knew some, but when I got there, it was like Chinese for me. It was like, what? What? No, my teachers never, sounded like this. Where's the pencil is red and the window is open and all those easy things, And so for me, it was like a cultural shock. And then everything turned into a really interesting experience, the whole
So
thing.
after the Che period, was it an intentional step to towards Hollywood or towards the industry,
No.
this industry, or just
I've
started getting
been.
offers?
No, the first film I ever did for this industry was, well, I was 19, and I got the part because I learned the whole thing phonetically. I didn't know what I was saying, and that's absolutely the truth. And yeah, I would ask everyone, "What is this weapons?" Oh, that's weapons. Oh, okay. It was a film for the movie of the week for NBC. Oh. Joseph Sargent directed. Melissa Gilbert was in it. Martin Sheen, Mike Farrell. It was a really, really great cast. And it was about the nuns that were killed in El Salvador, in El Salvador, in the 80s. Mm-hmm. And so it was about that, the guerrillas, and that. And I remember getting my part because of, you know, I learned it phonetically. And then but it wasn't until I worked on this play in Mexico in the National Theatre Company with Jose Quintero. Jose Quintero was at that time considered an expert in O'Neill's plays on Broadway. And Bellas Artes, the National Theatre Company, and the U.S. Embassy in Mexico co-produced this play, the only comedy that O'Neill wrote, Our Wilderness. As a part of the celebrations for the O'Neill Centennial, this and that. Mm-hmm. And then I got, that was the first time I played a lead on stage. Mm-hmm. And Jose Quintero was living in New York at that time. And we used to talk about the possibility of, you know, moving and just getting out of the cocoon. Mm-hmm. And that was my first, that year I went to New York for the first time. Mm-hmm. And I loved it. And I say, I think I'm coming back. And then I moved to New York.
So did you, and the English became easier quickly?
Of course not. I remember my first time at the movies. It was, I'll never forget that. It was a room with a view with Helena Bonham Carter and Daniel Day Lewis, right? Uh-huh. And I was like, where are the subtitles? Please, someone help me. I didn't get a word. And it was English, yeah. From England. So that was like, what the F? I think I'm going back. This is not going to work. And then my girlfriend, we met each other doing this film with Raul Julia and Hermana Sante in Mexico, in San Miguel de Allende, which is a beautiful, beautiful town. And we fell in love there. Mm. And that she was living in New York. And I said, that's that. I'm out of here. As we say in Mexico, jalan más un par de tetas que un par de carretas. Tú sabes lo que yo te digo. No, I don't believe I said that. No, that's what everybody thought, you know. Right. Oh yeah, you need a girl to move. No, it was all together. It was the whole thing together, and I fell in love, and I said, yeah, let's go, man. So I closed everything in Mexico, and most of my friends and people who knew me, they thought I was crazy, and that you have your name here, and what are you gonna do anywhere else? And I thought, I only have one life, you know. I'm just gonna try to do whatever I want with it, and whenever there's love, you know, you gotta go for it, please. And so it was really hard because when I got to New York, I thought I knew some English to defend myself while I was going to school and all that. Mm-hmm. But I just couldn't get anything. Mm-hmm. But then I took three different courses of English here and there and speech classes and da. And that was the first time that I stopped acting for a whole year. Mm-hmm. Being on the National Theatre Company in Mexico, doing sometimes three plays a year, that was for me really hard. I had come from doing Strindberg's The Ghost Sonata, and then I from doing Our Wilderness and Richard III. I was playing the Prince of Wales, of course, not Richard III. I was a kid. And
all good things in time.
Yeah, and so when I got to New York, I I had enough money to survive for a couple of months, but I started working right away in this place called The Underground. Mm. It was in Union Square, 17th and Washington, I think. No, Broadway and 17th, yeah. In Union Square. And it was crazy. It was crazy. I remember, you know, I was a busboy. I would help at the reception stamp everyone's hands. If anybody wanted to drink, they needed to show me their IDs and da-da-da-da-da. And I remember it was 3 in the morning one night, and they sent me across the street to get some milk. It was winter, and of course I was freezing, and they told me, oh, Damien, here, boom, they gave me $10, and they say, please, go get, we ran out of milk, we get some, but there's the milk. And all I heard was, milk. And I went across the street and I said, fuck, he said something about milk, but before milk, he said something before milk. What the fuck, what was that? So I stayed there in the milk section like for hours. Mm. Like, he said something before milk. It's not just simple milk. And then this guy comes into the store. I said, damn it, we're waiting for the milk. And I'm like, yeah, hold on. And then I zoom in into this word that says homogeneizada. Homogenized milk. I said, yeah, that's the word, homogenized milk. Boom, got it. That's how difficult it was for me because I just couldn't get anything. And
back home, you had a full career. You were established.
I was already, the Miami Chin in Mexico. And then I started working in this Mexican restaurant, that El Rosa Mexicano in the Upper East Side on 56th and 1st. Mm-hmm. And that's when I learned to make guacamoles. And I became really, really good, man. I still hold the record for 39 guacamoles in one lunch. I was flying from one table to another. It was like,
you next. Made guacamole at each table?
Yeah. That's the deal with that restaurant.
That's their thing.
They have this card that you prepare before the day begins, and it has everything in it. The molcajetes, which is the volcanic stone. That's where you make the guacamole. Not only guacamoles, but any sauce. That's, you know, a special container that makes everything more delicious. And so that's, I was doing that, then fixing coffees, preparing coffees, all kinds of coffees and desserts and stuff, because I was a busboy. Mm-hmm. I was not a waiter. And I remember there was one time, there was this table with a Mexican family, mm-hmm. and the girl, when like she was looking at me like, I know this guy. And then she talked to her dad, you know, I was seeing that, and I was like, oh fuck. She's like, excuse me, my daughter says you're an actor in Mexico. I said, yeah, everyone, you know, confuses me with that guy, you know, everyone is like, they think I am that, you know. No, I'm Puerto Rican, you know, I was born here. and it was quite an experience all that time. It was like, for me, it was like doing a play almost, because every night I would go downstairs where the locker rooms were and change into this character and then go and do the same play with different audiences every night. And I think half of the English I know, I learned it there, and it was really, really good. It was a hard time for me, but it was really good. I miss that.
So you went back home eventually to work in more films and things?
I went back after a year to do a TV series in Mexico, and then to get some more money, mm-hmm. and then continue the adventure. But then I booked 4 commercials for Pacific Bell. I don't think Pacific Bell exists anymore. When they called me to do that, I said, no, you know, I don't go for commercials. I'm not a model. Come on, please. No. This is the deal. There's one commercial in English and 3 in Spanish. There's going to be a shot in Los Angeles, and they're going to be shooting that in Los Angeles. And then, but the character needs to play soccer. I said, that's me. So I love soccer, right? So I went in there to the audition, and I got it because I play soccer. And then I moved to Los Angeles to shoot that, and I said, oh, this is a lot nicer regarding the weather. Mm-hmm. It's a lot more like Mexico City. It's a lot more, a lot less expensive than New York. Mm-hmm. So I moved to New York, and I had broken up with my girlfriend also. It was a big deal. Mm-hmm. And So that's how I got to Los Angeles. But then I stayed here for 4 years or five, and then I closed the whole thing and I said, no, nothing's happening here. And I was doing films, you know, back and forth in Mexico anyway. So, and then I just stayed in Mexico for a while, and then I came back 5 years ago.
So you kind of had your better life experience in New York, it sounds like, more than.
Oh, yeah, absolutely. No, my better life in every sense. A better life compared to my character, and a better life because I was also working with no papers. I didn't have any work permits or anything. Of course, I didn't have to cross the border like my paisanos have or do across the desert or the river or in a really nasty circumstances. But because I had a passport and I had a visa, but anyway, I didn't have any work permit when I worked in that restaurant. And so that was that. And it is, you can get the sense of, shit, man, they're gonna come in anytime and ask for the real thing, you know? And that was the last amnesty that we got in the United States in 85 when I got to New York. And that's how I applied for, you know, the proper documentation and all that afterwards, because I got in here before that time. So I mean, at that time. So it's that's going on in every politician's table right now as we speak. You know, that's that debate going on and on and on. That a new amnesty, a new immigration reform is needed now.
Yeah. Well, we seem it's a very fascinatingly hypocritical element of our country to be, because you know the urge to have workers here that would work at a price has been going on for, you know, 30 years,
Yeah,
40 years,
that's
and
right.
now all of a sudden it's time to go. It's very
Yeah,
strange.
it's time to go for politicians who lie to the public, you know, because it's a lot easier for them to lie to everybody instead of, you know, fixing the problem. Immigration has been a universal phenomenon ever since I remember, and it will continue to be so. But no one cares. No one really cares. Not Mexico and not the United States. They don't care for these 11 million human beings because everyone needs them. But they don't want to recognize that. They don't want to actually say that. And they need them to be undocumented because that's the way it works a lot better. Because they cannot ask for better salaries if they are, you know, if they have the proper documentation to go on strike and then demand better conditions, right? And Mexico doesn't want to, they don't need to take care of them, you know, so they better go somewhere else and be somebody else's problem. Because when they come here, they send tons of money every year to Mexico, so that's good for everyone. So everyone benefits from these human beings, but them, and that's a point. A lot of people don't really know what the immigration phenomenon is like until they have seen the film, for example. When I have a lot of Anglo friends that have seen A Better Life, and they sent me a couple of emails saying, I can't believe that my perspective towards this issue changed drastically in 2 hours. You know, now I know what it is. This is not a political issue, it's a human issue.
So in the movie, I mean, I actually I think I bet Pete Hammond that I said I would eat a hat, literally eat a hat if you got nominated, because I felt like the movie hadn't done enough business, and you know there were all these other people chasing after your nomination and that slot. And indeed, he saw what he saw with you at different Q and A's and things was a connection to the actors. And to people who are out there about how somehow you were connecting with people in a way that other actors weren't this year. I mean, obviously the performance is great, and that's a given.
Thank you.
But you know, there was something about you, I think, that connected. Did you feel that? Did you feel like you were talking, having a conversation with?
We traveled a lot with the film. We went everywhere to present it and then have Q and A's with the public. That's something that I enjoy a lot every time that happens, you know, even when I'm working on a play, when I did that by the Waters of Babylon right here at the Geffen Playhouse, every Tuesday you have that chance. People can stay and have a Q&A with the actors and director. And I love those Tuesdays because that's the real thing, you know, that's when the real communication happens. And I remember every time we went out with A Better Life, that was a really, really interesting part of the whole experience, you know, the Q&A, because people have been touched by it. Their hearts have been, you know, broken by the story, but then their minds have been open too. And then we took the film to Washington, and that was intense too. We had the chance to go to a Capitol building and talk to a couple of senators, and then to the White House to talk to Cecilia Muñoz, and I believe in the power of cinema. I believe in how powerful 2 hours of filmmaking can be to change people's perspective, so that's our biggest hope. After all this, when we got the attention from the Independent Spirit Awards and then SAG, we were already happy, you know. We were already really, really feeling strong in terms of getting more and more people to see the film. And then when the Academy nomination came last week, wow, it seems forever. A lot of things have happened. Our expectations towards the possibility of this film to be watched by many, many more people grew and grew and grew, and so that's basically what we want, what any artist want, you know. We want our work to be seen, and but especially this film has to go out there and get to the right people, to get to the right eyes, to the people who make decisions and take decisions and sign laws and stuff and all
Yes, but I mean, I guess what I was asking though is more: do you have a kin? I mean, it's all interesting, but do you feel kinship with the acting community here? Do you feel like
I
you've
guess,
had a
yeah. We had a couple of nice SAG screenings, and my fellow peers were really, really, you know, into the whole thing, and I guess they relate to me. In the sense that they know what I've been through. And that's pretty much the same struggle that any actor goes through, you know, before anything happens. And they see in me the possibility of possible, right? It's like, yeah, there you go. You see, it is possible. Look at this guy, right? So it's easy when you see somebody like that, a story like mine. A lot of people can relate to that, and especially my fellow peers. Not only here, anywhere in the world. I've been lucky enough to work in many places in the world, and of course Latin America, and then I just did another film in Ireland. I've shot a lot of films in Spain, and of course in Mexico. And that's what people tell you, you know. Then it is possible. And I'm not saying that this is the pinnacle of any actor's dreams or anything like that, you know. It just means what it means. And it means that, you know, this explosion of public recognition happens in from one day to another, you know, because a lot of people know you work from Mexico or in Bolivia or Colombia or Irlanda or España. But now pretty much everyone, you know, turns and looks and see. I mean, it's not that they know your name, but they go like, "Who the fuck is that?" You know, that's a question right now. Who the fuck is that? You know, what is the world really coming to an end?
They have to figure out how to spell it first.
Exactly. Yeah, the Mian Bichir, and then they think that's not Mexican. What is the Perez? What is the Gonzalez? What is the... Well, that's not even Mexican anyway. That's Spanish, you know? And But Huitzilopochtli, Tezcatlipoca, Cuauhtémoc, Los Cuauhtémocs, Los Xochitls, those are Mexican names. But anyway,
Damien De La Toro, we were hoping to
Guillermo del Toro, that's you don't get any more Spanish than that. That's so Spanish. Yeah, but Mexican, there are just a few names out there that are still real Mexican. If we talk about Nahuatl and Aztecs and that, But anyway, yeah, Bichir, it's a Lebanese last name. There was a lot of immigration in Mexico, up in the north of Mexico where my parents are from, in Torreon. So like I don't know, man, because I didn't go any further back in order to realize or to find out exactly, you know, what the deal was. But my parents are Mexican, my parents' parents too, my parents' parents are Mexican, so that's pretty much all I know. And Demian is from the Hermann Hesse novel, Demian, you know, Steppenwolf, Wolf, Siddhartha, and all those guys, all those novels. And so that's my real name.
It doesn't sound like you've had a career path. It doesn't sound like you've been a careerist. It sounds like you've gone through life working, liking the work, but kind of going with the flow.
Absolutely, yeah. That too. The only thing that has always been clear is that the things that I don't want to do. Of course, you have like a some kind of idea of the career you want, and then you have a lot of examples for that, right? You think, oh yeah, Ben Kingsley, yes, please. You know, nice. Morgan Freeman, oh yeah. Jack Nicholson, nice. Daniel Day, Robert De Niro, Pacino,
But it's funny,
Hoffman.
you mentioned guys who are all character actors, and you kind of had the rep as the good looking guy. You know, you've kind of the leading man, the handsome leading man, the Hispanic energy kind of guy.
Yeah, right. Thank you. No. Oh, man, not with this face. Come on, you gotta be kidding.
Well, I mean,
No.
that's on Weeds. You're the, you know, the debonair guy.
A
You're in a
what?
lot
A
of
weed?
movies. You've been kind of the charismatic, handsome
Well,
Hispanic.
yeah, but you know, I jumped from Fidel Castro to Carlos Galindo, and that's pretty much what I, and that's 25 pounds difference from any handsome whatever
So you really see yourself as a character
stereotype.
actor. You live as a character actor.
Well, it's not that I, you know, I don't label myself, you know, I don't label myself. Some other people do, you know, maybe.
Well, I always think Brad Pitt is really a character actor. He just happens to be really handsome and tall.
Well, he's
But
an
he
amazing
likes,
actor. Yeah,
yeah.
he's an amazing actor. He's a wonderful actor, and he's done some really interesting, you know, physical changes in his career. And Josh Clooney has done that too. And of course Gary Oldman, you know, pff, are you kidding me? And so yeah, I don't consider myself you know, handsome, as you say. Yeah, I am not. I can't be. I mean, come on, really. And so, but I do believe in that. I believe in jumping from one character to another and try to go as different as you can. And the other day I was taking a look at some pictures of the films that I've done. And yeah, I've been having fun, you know. I can do that. I don't care the way I look. I don't care how I look. I just, or how the character looks. I believe in what the character needs, and then we'll go for that. And it's very hard for me to gain weight, for example. And I did it twice already for Fidel Castro and for Carlos Galindo in A Better Life, and then to lose that weight, man, it takes forever. And I just, you know, sometimes you have to say no because the industry's imagination is so narrow sometimes that all you need is to do weeds, to work on weeds and be this, you know, whatever, a character that we created. You know, I have nothing to do with that. This is a guy that, you know, can spank you or grab a gun in no time, right? At the same time. So, and then I got like three different blockbusters offers to play the same character. Exactly the same character, same lines even, you know. It's like, oh really, are you kidding me? And and of course for me it's easy to say no because I know what I don't want. And then a film like this, like A Better Life, comes along and you die for it. You know, it's like any actor's dream.
Yeah. It's definitely challenging not to get... We're talking to... what's his name? He got nominated last year for the Tarantino movie. The German... And he was saying how, you know, when he first came to America when he was in his teenage years or his early 20s, and a German actor here said to him, you know, if you work here, you're going to end up being the villain, being the, you know, evil Nazi 9 out of 10 times. That's all you're going to do for the rest of your... You'll have a career, you'll be famous, you whatever, but that's... You have to decide whether you want to do that. And he went back to Germany and went back to the stage.
Huh.
Because the idea of it was too horrifying.
And now he became famous doing that wonderful work. Christoph Waltz. But then he's been doing some other great things, you know, this film about the elephants with Robert Pattinson and
Carnage.
And some other great things, you know.
But challenging not to get sucked into that.
It's difficult, you know. Yeah. It's difficult because, you know, I'm always going to have my accent and I'm always going to be Mexican and da 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 da. But I'm sure there's going to be some great, you know, visionary guys like Chris Weitz or like Steven Soderbergh who can give a guy like me the chances that, you know, Anthony Quinn got, for example. You know, what a guy, you know, what a beautiful human being, what a enormous, colossal actor. And you know, I believe in that. So in order for me to get the parts that I want, I have to say no to the ones that I don't like.
It's a gutsy thing.
It's a what?
It's a gutsy thing to do.
It is because, you know, we all want houses and we all want to help others and we all want this and that, da 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 da. But me, I'm fine, you know, I'm okay. I everything I need to be happy, it's free, so I'm fine.